I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
You may be seated. We have several public hearings before we get into our regular meeting. And if you wish to address council on any of the public hearings, you'll just stand, state your name, and address your comments to council. The first public hearing is an amendment to the budget for fiscal year 2012-13. And I believe you have a copy of proposed expenditures that amendment will address. Is there anyone that would like to speak to this budget amendment? Yes, sir.
Mayor Biology and Council, I'm Chief Billy Hanks of Christiansburg Fire Department. Christiansburg Fire Department respectfully requests Town Council's approval to purchase a Pierce Manufacturing 75-foot aerial ladder truck. This purchase, if approved, will be funded with monies that have been set aside in the town's fire apparatus replacement fund. A number of considerations factor into our decision to make this purchase. Before stating these considerations, let me provide you with the specifications of the apparatus. The apparatus is equipped with a 75-foot aerial ladder capable of supporting 850 pounds at the tip extended. The ladder will have a pre-pipe waterway master stream device, enabling the apparatus to provide 1,500 gallons a minute flow at the master stream level. It'll be a 2,000 gallon minute pump, fire attack hose lines, a full load of hose, which is 1,000 feet of hose. Standard equipment will include self-contained breathing apparatus, hand tools, ground ladders. As equipped, the truck will serve the town as both an aerial ladder for rescue, elevated water streams, and safer roof working, as well as a full service pumper truck. Our considerations in seeking this type of apparatus are as follows. The town currently possesses only three pieces of firefighting apparatus that belong to the town. We own two pumpers and 102-foot platform aerial ladder truck. The town population we serve and the town area have grown greatly in the past 30 years. The town is experiencing more construction of multi-story, multi-family residential dwellings. The density of housing has become greater, and with concurrent tightening of access roads, these areas including more cul-de-sacs. Continued growth with larger buildings such as the Backcountry building, the new CCS data building, and other buildings, you know, including the commercial areas around where the Holiday Inns have been built. The department seeks greater safety in our roof operations, particularly in residential sections of the town. Our current aerial ladder is versatile and a reliable aerial device, but however, due to its size and weight, it is greatly hampered in operations around townhomes, condominiums, and single-family dwellings. Department members feel their safety and roof operations would be greater by working off of an aerial ladder opposed to working off ground or roof ladders. As the town has the intent to build an additional station in town, we feel it would be prudent in having aerial apparatus responding from such a location as well as our current location. The multi-purpose apparatus would be a force multiplier for our department. It would also enable us to have greater flexibility in both being a pumper truck and an aerial ladder. If we wouldn't just have a ladder truck, we could use it as an engine also. This unit is capable to provide an aerial water stream using only two firefighters, both of whom will be safely on the ground. The proposed apparatus has a shorter wheelbase at 36 feet, has a lighter total weight than our current aerial device already in use. These attributes will allow us to place the aerial ladder in many locations not accessible by the larger truck. We do not feel that it would be an unnecessary redundancy in having two aerial ladder trucks in service, rather have greater ability to respond and mitigate emergency situations. We're looking at a demo truck right now. It's a demonstrator truck. It's 1 year old. In the past, we haven't ever looked at demo trucks, but this one came available and we thought it was worth looking at, you know, to see if we could save some money on the unit. The demo truck's being offered to us at a cost of $690,506 without the equipment. The new unit, if we built a new unit, if we spec'd a new unit, built a new unit just like it, it would run in the neighborhood of $732,104. This is a cost savings of $41,598. Loose equipment run approximately $46,534.50. That would bring the total cost of the truck to $737,040.50. New unit, if we purchase a new unit or ordered a new unit, usually have a year lead time on buying, on getting the truck delivered from the time you ordered. This truck is available now. We have the money in the truck reserve fund. We can purchase the apparatus through the city of Suffolk contract that they have bid out on the prices, so we would be able to jump through the bid process. Our current ladder truck is 25 years old. We feel we would benefit more if we did a partial refurb on the hydraulics on the current ladder truck. We could probably extend that ladder truck's life for another 15 to 20 years. We've got some bids on that pricing on that. It's anywhere from $85,000 to $100,000 to do a partial refurb. If we were to put the unit on the market, the old ladder truck on the market, and try to sell the old ladder truck being 25 years old, the truck probably wouldn't bring $50,000. We know our truck is worth more than $50,000 to this town and to the department. So therefore, we feel like if we did a partial refurb on the truck, we could gain some life out of the truck. And the truck's still testing, still UL tests as well, still pump tests well, and it's still a low mileage truck. If we had to order a new platform ladder truck to replace our current truck, we're looking at $1.2 million to replace that truck. In closing, the members of the department would like you to know that it's a privilege to serve our community, and the department is very grateful for the exceptional support that the leaders of the town, county council, and the town management has given us over the years. And we'd like to thank you for this consideration. I've got a picture of the truck, and can you have that?
Can you clarify, you're talking about doing the retrofit on the other truck next fiscal year.
Next fiscal year. Not this upcoming one, but the next fiscal year. This is a picture of the truck that we're looking at. It's a Pierce truck. It's a six-man cab truck. 2,000-gallon minute pump. It's got a 500-gallon water tank on it. It's got a 75-foot straight stick aerial ladder. Has an extendable waterway. The waterway is right here. You can lock the waterway in place, and when you extend the ladder up, it's only at halfway where you can release it. It'll extend out to 75 feet. That's a two-person operation truck rather than a three- or a four-person operation truck that we have when we put the platform in service. That truck could run not only on our commercial district fires, we could run on residential fires too. The thing we've been plagued with over the past few years is you notice in all the neighborhoods now, everybody's going to the metal roofs again. When it's snowing and there's ice on the roofs and we have to get on the roof, it's not really a safe situation. This truck is light enough that we can get it up in the driveway of a house and be able to set it up and work off of that ladder if we had to get on the roof. Our big ladder, our 102-foot platform ladder, that truck weighs about 98,000 pounds, and residential driveways don't accept them real well. This truck right here is about 65,000, I think.
Is it tall enough to get on the county government center again, if necessary?
It'll get on the government center. It won't get on the courthouse.
That's what I meant, the courthouse.
We could go on the parking garage in the back of the courthouse, and we could probably reach the fourth floor. Mm-hmm. But we're not looking to take our platform out of service. We want to keep our platform in service. It's 102-foot. We discovered when we had the fire, during construction, that it will clear the roof of the building. And done a terrific job there. The old truck's still a good truck. We've been fighting fire in Christiansburg in 1988, when we bought the platform ladder truck, we gave an engine up to buy the platform ladder truck. We had three engines in 1988. So we give an engine up we replaced an engine with a platform ladder. That left us with two engines and a platform. So in 1988, our population was about 9,000 people, and we're about almost 22,000 now. And in our area is about doubled in that time frame too. And we've been still trying to service the citizens of Christiansburg with just three apparatus. Once we get the new station built, you know, we'd like to have a ladder truck in each station, an engine in each station, which, you know, if we were able to purchase this truck, we could do that right now with the current equipment that we have. One more slide. I don't know if it shows the other side of the truck. Yeah, that's the right side of the truck. It's got full compartmentation on it on both sides, and then does have a hose bed that will hold 1,000 feet of hose. Be glad for any questions.
Do you have any reliability that somebody else is not going to bid on this truck?
That truck is first come, first served right now. They actually brought the truck in here from Illinois Horse Club.
And where is it now?
It's in our station.
Is it under 24-hour guard? Somebody else can come look at it?
We're not letting anybody look at it right now, but there are other people that have inquired about the truck, and they reminded us 2 weeks ago that it was first come, first serve, and we were glad to keep the truck and try it out and use it and take it around and see where we can use it and where we can't use it, which we have. Pretty extensively. I think we've had the truck since a week before Christmas. They have had, the membership has had this truck all over town. I mean, they have found nowhere that this truck won't go. They even took it to the new Holiday Inn and it'll reach the Port Forge and all that. Set up in front of the building. But, we've been trying, weighing the factors, buy a new ladder truck, give our old ladder truck away, or try to get the best bang for the buck. And, you know, for roughly $837,000 to $845,000, I have two trucks that's going to service another 15-25 years.
And Chief, you said that this will give you two engines, one ladder and one platform at this point?
Correct.
The $737,000 for this expenditure, is that listed in the budget amendment?
No, sir. This came up after we'd advertised. There is actually something they were looking at it, but we didn't know that they were really serious about it until we'd advertised. So it's not part of the advertisement. That's why we bring it up here in a public hearing. Okay. Can't take action on it.
But you have the money on reserve right now. Is that what you said?
On reserve fund, we have that much money.
It's a little over $1 million.
A little over $1 million right now. So we still have a cushion. You know, our next oldest engine is a 94. Trucks, when Chief Amberley put them, in the budgets in 94, that truck was set up on a 25-year replacement. We'll have to work toward replenishing the truck replacement fund, to be able to replace that truck, when it's ready to be replaced also.
So what action do we need to take? Do we need to take action on this?
If we take action, we could take action tonight separately from the budget amendment. That's just okay. Individual, since the money's there, I would think.
Just a matter of giving approval for them to spend what they already have in that.
Certainly know their
need. Fire department reserve fund. The fire department reserve fund is separate.
Right.
They're right from the general fund.
Yeah, they actually have two. One is the Virginia Fire Programs. Actually, three.
Yeah.
For this purpose, there's two that they can use, and that's the fire truck reserve fund that the council has been putting money into every year for quite some time. And then they have the monies that have accumulated from what's called the Virginia Fire Programs, which really can only be spent for that purpose, and that's close to $500,000, and the other one's a little over. So combined, there's a little over $1 million in those two things.
And the third one is the building.
That's a county fire, Virginia Fire Program. So it's Virginia Fire Program's money that can only be spent through the fire department, but it comes through the county.
Through the county.
Versus directly through the county.
And we use that county fund to replace county equipment.
That's not associated with the building fund?
No.
Okay.
No.
I looked at it today and sort of blend it together right now. Appreciate it.
Well, are you looking for a motion? Is that what, are we looking for?
No, we're not in session yet. Thank you, Chief. Thanks. Any further questions on the piece of equipment that the fire department would like to purchase?
Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to speak to the budget amendment?
Sir, I would like to make a clarification on the budget amendment. On the garbage trucks, they will not be able to get them delivered before the first part of June or before the end of this fiscal year. So we can take the $520,000 out of the amendment and not have to act on it at this time and put it in next year's budget since that's when we'll be paying for it. However, if we bid the trucks and have a firm price before I can sign the contract to order the truck, we'd have to take action to authorize me to spend that money. I couldn't sign a contract during $54,000 or $500,000 without being in the budget somewhere or having y'all approve.
Well, the budget amendment is $812,000 less the $520,000.
Yes, sir. We can still go ahead and buy the trash cans out of this year's money that we had for trucks. We have enough money to do that and then get the trucks when they come in June or July or August. So it doesn't need to be in this year's budget, this budget amendment. That came up this week also after it's advertised.
And we're not taking action on this this evening.
No, we're not.
Yeah, exactly.
It would be $520,000 less than what.
Yes, thank you.
All right. Anyone else like to speak to this budget amendment? If not, then we'll close that public hearing. And number two is a conditional use permit request by Shaw Development, LLC, agent for property owner Anna M. Graves, for residential use at 115 Fisher Street. That's tax parcel 499-3-1. This is in the B3 General Business District. Is there anyone that would like to speak to this request? Yes, sir, Mr. Neal.
Good evening, Mayor, members of council. My name is John Neal. I'm an engineer with Gay Neal. I'm here tonight representing Shaw Development. Mr. Tom Rutledge, the general manager for Shaw, is here as well. I placed at your chairs three drawings. Our request is for a conditional use permit in the B3 district to allow residential use. The first drawing is just to kind of get you oriented with where we're talking about on Fisher Street. Fisher Street is off of Roanoke Street. If you know where the Duncan dealership and the garage sale or yard sale or flea market.
So Moore's building.
Okay, I think it has a CUP on it for that. So if you turn there, then you kind of make another left and then another left down Fisher Street, and you can actually see this site. This site is adjacent to Roanoke Street. And there's an old white house that's actually been condemned. I think it's officially been condemned by the town of Christiansburg. They've been trying to tear it down for quite a while now. There was some asbestos in the building and things like that that Shaw has taken upon themselves and has abated the asbestos from the site, and they're working towards getting that demolished. That old building
doesn't have any siding on it anymore, correct?
That's correct. It was moved as part of the abatement. It was an old train site.
Yeah, we're by the White House, front White House.
Yes, sir. And Shaw actually owns the adjacent property, which are known as the Fisher Street condominiums, which are on Fisher Street as well. What we view this as is kind of mostly an extension of that project. So if we flip onto the second page, this is the conceptual layout for the project. This is at the very end. Roanoke Street would be to the right of the page, as you're looking at it. Fisher Street condominiums would be to the left, running parallel with this site. We'd just be requesting 6 townhome units. These would be able to be sold individually. We do have parking that is off-street parking. Right now, the existing Fisher Street condominium has actually parking that pulls in off the street. But that's not allowed for any new development, so we have this one way in, one way out. And then the last, if you're interested in any of the details or the math involved, this is where we show where we get all the green space and the trees and everything that's required to develop the site. I'll be happy to answer any questions on that if you have any specific ones. That is generally the request. I'd certainly be happy to answer any questions you have. I think this would be a tremendous improvement for that property. Pretty much everything on Fisher Street is residential right now. And I think we were asked at the Planning Commission why this was zoned B3 if everything was residential on that site. And I think the general consensus was that way back in the day, everything was zoned B3 for a certain amount of distance off of Roanoke Street. But then when the bypass came in and Fisher Street was no longer connected to Roanoke Street, it really cut down on the opportunity for any type of business use. And Fisher Street would never be extended back out to Roanoke Street, so it was kind of cut off from any ideal commercial use. Be happy to answer any questions you have. Mr. Ruff is with us. I'm not sure if you have any specific to add.
I just want to state that during the Planning Commission public hearing, there were some great ideas that were brought up. Planning Commission was very helpful. They had requested, currently, you go to Fisher Street and it's a dead end right now because of the limited access for the 460 bypass. So they had requested that we put deed and easement in that lower entrance to make enough room for a school bus turnaround to pick the kids up off that street, which is a great idea, so we're going to accommodate that. Some of the questions were about that end unit. Of course, the property is not very attractive as it is today, and they had requested possibly some windows and stuff on that end unit. What we had compromised about was we would like to try to do that with vegetated landscaping and screening across that section right there. Reason being, it's close to the bypass and the noise and the traffic, stuff like that. They're smaller units, so the window kind of messes up the furniture placement and stuff like that in the unit. So we want to try to do it, make that end as attractive as possible with landscape. I think that and the turnaround and stuff is basically what they have. Planning Commission voted unanimously for approval, and they actually voted on it that night. And council so seated.
We'll discuss that when we get into regular session to amend the agenda.
Okay. Any other questions?
Well, how many stories are these?
These are 2-story ones.
Well, so that's 1,200 square feet.
Yes, sir.
This measure with my pen.
Right.
I could tell John's an engineer. Look at the pocket of his. Look at that.
The units are actually... they're set up the way that the site, the way the conceptual plan is shown, they're set up where they can be subdivided and conveyed separately. Mm-hmm. But the older units adjacent to them, the Fisher Street condos, they can be sold off separately as well through the condos. These would actually be townhouses, mm-hmm. but in today's market, none of them are sold, but they've stayed 100% rented.
Is that grass out there now, or what's out there now? Is it paved?
Big house, a lot of gravel.
Okay. I paid attention to this. So you're going to handle the stormwater with some BMP?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
By retention.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. This inline is present tonight, and I'm sure he will be happy to see the structure tore down. We had the asbestos survey. There was asbestos present. We hired a contractor, and all that has been abated and removed. And the next process, the only thing we have left to do is actually interior. I've got to apply for an actual demo permit, even though the environmental group did theirs. And then we have to do a state notification to the Department of Labor and Industry, basically Virginia OSHA, and you got to give them a 10 business day notification prior to any demolition. That notification has been sent in, and our 10 days was up yesterday. So we're ready to go.
You anticipate that these are going to be rental units, Mr.?
They are set up to subdivide, but yes, I would envision them being rentals. There's a variety of housing on the street. If you've ever driven down there, there's a single wide, double wide, single family, duplexes, condos, and these.
I sort of characterize it as almost infill development. There's almost nothing you can do with this property.
Yeah, the limited access.
I like it from that standpoint. It's infill. It's usually. Thank you. Good presentation.
You sort of referred to it, but I wasn't sure if council followed that. I think it's called a hammerhead turnaround.
Yes.
Would you maybe go, I'm not sure, maybe these people are smarter than I am, but they explained it during planning commission that everybody was a little bit concerned about school kids, if they were on a bus, if they could actually turn around. And if you might want to pick it up, you had said that you would put in some of these hammerhead spots to turn around.
Yeah, when you go down to the end of the road, basically, I'm assuming if the bus goes down there now, it turns around in yards. Pulls up, backs up, stuff like that. What happens when we put the lower entrance in, it's basically like a hammerhead. They'll be able to pull into our parking lot, back out into the road, and turn back around more safe.
There's no existing right-of-way. Fisher Street, when it was cut off, they did make accommodations for it to be a cul-de-sac, so you can't put in a traditional cul-de-sac. There's not enough right-of-way. So Shaw's going to dedicate a turnaround easement, a public access easement on that lower entrance to allow someone to pull in and back out and pull back down Fisher Street.
Yeah, the rest of the traffic will probably just pull in, drive all the way through it and back out. But we want to make the accommodation for the school bus. And that's a great point from planning commission.
Yeah. And for Councilman Hupper's benefit, that'll all be reviewed when they submit a plan for development to Mr. Nelson. That'll all be reviewed. But
okay.
It's a good point. But they'll make sure ordinance, it will follow the ordinance.
Right. And the last thing I did just want everybody to know, we have actually, when we submitted the application, we were acting as agent. We had the property under contract. We have closed on that. So we are fee simple owners of the property. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to speak to this request? If not, then we'll close this public hearing. We'll go to the third, which is council's intention to adopt an ordinance in regards to revenue recovery for rescue squad service. This is something that's been discussed the last several months. I wonder, is there anyone here that would like to speak to this intention? Mr. Helms, this does not say we're doing it. It gives us the authority to do it. Is that right?
It's passed, yes, it's passing a resolution to allow us to be able to do it if we want to.
So it's simply giving us the authority to do it. Doesn't mean we're going to absolutely do it. Okay. Is there anyone that wants to speak to this intention? Joe's he's been speaking for the last 6 months. He's been speaking everywhere about it, so thank you. All right, we'll close that public hearing, and next is a resolution supporting the inclusion of the North Franklin Street Cambria Street intersection project in VDOT project programming and reprioritization of projects within the program. And Mr. Helms, you may have to explain that a little further.
Basically, it's VDOT's work plan, or to get it onto their work plan. And we want to add, well, the resolution says our first priority would be completing the widening of Pepper's Ferry Road, which they're working on. Second priority would be the intersection upgrade North Franklin Street and Cambridge Street, including study of functionality between Cambridge Street and Independence Boulevard, and potential for coordinated signal system, And then that's the new project we're adding. And then the third thing being a connector route between North Franklin Street and Pepper's Ferry Road.
And none of that is on the, in the six-year plan of UDOT?
Right now, the first one and third one are in VDOT's work plan, not on the six-year plan yet. And then we'll add the second one as our second priority, the intersection study of Cameron Street, North Franklin, all the way to study all the way to Independence, which would take care of the Patrick's Way intersection.
All right.
What this means is every year, the town gets, still gets federal money that flows through. We get, no longer get state, VDOT has no money for localities for new projects. It used to be probably in the neighborhood of $400,000 to $500,000 a year we would get. But now we still get probably between $400,000 and $500,000, something like that. What's our allocation here? It's over 400, I think. Wayne, do you know? Okay. But anyway, so the town still accrues some money that comes from the federal government through VDOT. That, and we have to have a plan for how we would spend that once we have enough money to actually do an improvement project. While the 114 project's under construction, that has to be our first priority, is to make sure it gets built, finished out. And then the street committee has looked and thinks that the intersection at Cambria Street and North Franklin would be a good one to bump up, because it would, the connector road would probably be somewhere between $15 and $20 million to make that connector between 114 and North Franklin Street. So it's more realistic to expect that we would have this other Cambria Street improvement with the intersection there in a shorter time frame.
Do you think within our lifetime that may become a reality?
Lightning struck on 114, but if the planning is not done for it, probably not. But you have to move ahead with that.
Does this resolution go to the resolution will be submitted to VDOT, and I guess a copy to the Metropolitan Planning Organization. All right, anyone else to speak to this request? If not, then we'll close this portion of the public hearing, and Christiansburg Town Council is now in session.
Mr. Mayor, prior to opening up the session, I'd ask for we amend the agenda.
Okay.
And I would ask that we amend the agenda based on the same provision as before, 2.2.3711A3, for the discussion of acquisition or disposition of real property, whereby discussing an open session or open meeting could adversely impact our strategy or negotiating posture.
And that's for closed session?
Yes, sir. I would ask that to be admitted following the closed session under section 6A. Make it 6A2, if you would.
Do we have a second?
Second.
A motion and a second to add that closed session to the other closed session as we did at our last meeting. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. And Mr. Helms, I believe we are going to have a recommendation for amendment change to
add voting on the Fisher Street CUP. Y'all will.
So moved.
Motion?
Second.
And a second to amend the agenda to include council's vote on the Fisher Street project. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Motion carries, and that will be item number 26R6. Item number six.
Close meeting on 7 then?
Yeah.
Okay. Close meeting, I believe, is number 7. Okay.
Sir, one up here. Do you want to vote on the fire truck?
Yes, we need to put that. We need to put that on the agenda.
I'll make a motion that we take action or discuss anyway, and potentially take action on the request.
I'll second
the fire truck.
All right, and we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
And that will be item number 7, and the closed session then becomes item 8. All right. You have a copy of the minutes. And I need to let you know that I made a mistake last meeting when we started announcing committee assignments. And I announced that the cemetery committee would be Mr. Stipes and Mr. Huppert. And that was incorrect. It's Mr. Hall and Mr. Huppert. And I have asked the clerk to make that notation in the minutes to correct that. Is that okay with council?
And Mr. Mayor, I have two modifications to the minutes, if I may. And it would be under section 2B, the discussion that we had in relation to modifying the meeting schedule for the first and third, second and fourth. And it's underlined 11, beginning with the start of the first full sentence of that line, where it says Councilman Hall. It says, agreed that serving on council takes precedence. I'd ask for it to state that Councilman Hall stated that serving on council should take precedence over all of the board meetings. And I would ask for the rest of that entire sentence to be omitted.
You got that, Ms. Clerk?
Yes, sir.
And the second section, I think that might be, it involves Councilman Stipes. It's six lines later. It says, Councilman Stipes commented that this matter was recently discussed and acted on. I don't believe he said it was acted on by council because we never actually acted on it. We discussed it. We never acted or did anything with it. We just decided we would set that aside to our meeting on organizational meeting at the beginning of January. And frankly, I just didn't want Mr. Councilman Stipes to be misquoted on that behalf because we didn't actually take any action on it back in, I think it was June or July that we discussed.
And I'm misremembered, and I'll accept that provision.
I wasn't trying to check on you. I just remember we talked about it. We never actually acted.
Yeah, that's correct. I'm fine with that. I thought we did, but we didn't.
And that would be the only two modifications,
okay.
Mr. Mayor.
You've got those changes, Ms. Clerk?
Yes, sir.
Do I hear a motion to accept the minutes as amended?
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second to accept the minutes of the last meeting as amended. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. This is our citizens' hearing portion, and we have our good friend, Ms. Becky Martin, back with us from Blacksburg Transit.
Good evening. How are you guys doing?
Good evening.
How are you?
I'm driving.
Okay.
I'm driving.
You doing all right, Becky?
I'm doing great. Trying to hear the score on my daughter's playing varsity tonight, basketball. Trying to hear the score to see how she's doing. So I'll have to wait till after this to see. All right, so thank you all very much for inviting me back to give you guys an update on how we're doing and give you an update on the things that the working group has been working on. So, let's see here. First of all, we'll start with numbers. This goes back, these will be the October numbers because this is where the working group had reviewed, so these will be the numbers that you had gotten there. One of the things I just wanted to talk about was we have been extremely successful with GAR. We've had several people, successful is kind of an interesting word here. We've had several people that have been riding GAR that have graduated back into owning a car. They have been riding us regularly, and they have been using us for daycare, getting to jobs, and since they've been able to obtain regular employment and do that on a regular basis, they've been able to get a car. They've been very appreciative, and so now they're just using us on occasional basis because to them, that's what they were hoping to be able to do. So, you know, it's very interesting to see what people's goals are. As those people have kind of graduated off of the GAR system, we've also noticed, though, that new people are coming on. We're still getting some new people. We had 21 new people who inquired about us this month. And so new people who are kind of falling in between the cracks, you know, of the system, who are kind of learning to, who are looking for jobs, doing different things, or calling us, trying to find the system so that they can ride. We are working with somebody new, though, who's helping us, that I just want to talk just a few minutes about. We are working with the New River Valley Agency on Aging, and we're working with a lady called Julie Bursey. And she is somebody that we all have invested into this mobility coordinator position. It's a New River Valley position, and she actually helps coordinate the whole New River Valley coordination area, because that's her job. So we sat down and talked with her, and we asked her if she could help us, and specifically in Christiansburg, because her job is to talk to people that do kind of fall in between the cracks, and she really does a lot of hands-on, one-on-one. She can get on the bus with people, help them ride. We kind of learned about her because she was helping people in Blacksburg ride the bus, because she just kind of fills in and helps people. She was doing it without talking to us. We found out about her and said, well, let's coordinate this instead of you just doing it. So she's helping us, but we specifically told her that we had things that we were working on here. And so she will go out and really do that one-on-one. And so she doesn't use the regular advertising, internet kind of things, which we know is not the best way to reach people. She really gets out there and talks with people and kind of uses the network to talk with people. So we're going to try that out, and I'll be back, and I'm going to bring her here in the next couple of months, and we'll give you an update and let you know how this is working. But I wanted to let you know that we have a new resource that we're working with, and that we're out there coordinating, and we'll let you know how that's going. And seeing how this is happening and how this mobility coordinator is working in the region. As I said, she's helping us in Blacksburg as well. People on the ADA service, helping people get on SmartWay. She's doing all of that. But specifically, I've been asking her to help with Christiansburg. Our Explorer numbers are steady, straight on. We're kind of starting to find a rhythm. I think you're going to probably find that it's starting to be steady out. Our commuter route is running about that 13 to 14 average in the afternoon to about 10 or 11 in the 13 to 14 in the morning, 10 to 11 in the afternoon. We're still working on trying to see if we can't increase that. Our second commuter route has about 6 people. One of our regulars, right after it started, unfortunately lost her job. We're very sad to hear that. But we're hoping she'll get a new job and be able to ride with us again. It's amazing how much about people's lives that you find through transit. I know all about their lives and what's happening with them and what's going on. Here's our total ridership. We're running about 2455. So we're really right in the mark of what we've been doing in past years. And then we're doing steady ridership. One of the big things you'll see, you should have in your report as you're looking through on your copy, is you should have, I don't think I have one, but it should be a sheet that shows shelters. Thank you very much, Councilman Van Hooser. And it should show all the different shelters out there and different amenities and stuff. It's a plan that we've been working on. And what I want to do is just briefly go through that plan with you. Pictures are worth 1,000 words, and so it kind of easy to show you the pictures so you can kind of see what's going on with our shelters, what is current, what we're doing, and the funding. We already have the funding. It's FY13 funding for these that you're about to see. The funding has not been released yet. That's why we haven't done it yet. But we're ready to roll as soon as the money gets released. And so they should be up no later than summer or fall, and we'll be working with the Christiansburg Public Works. So the first thing we're gonna do is look at ones that are already out there that need roof replacements and amenities. So the first one here is the CVS. If you haven't seen, we love the fact that we have some public-private partnership going on. We love what they've done out there. Have y'all seen that? Really nice.
CVS did that.
Yes, and it was really nice, and we love that because obviously that means that they're supporting what's going on. We're changing the roofs because flat roofs don't do well with the rain, And also from Blacksburg perspective, not that out here you have it as much, but we always worry about vandalism, so we like the dome roofs better, honestly. So there's a couple reasons that we like the dome roofs better. So we're going to, and these are older and they need new roofs, so we'll be going to a dome roof, and that is one of the changes that we'll be making here. You'll also notice that it needs a trash can, so we're going to upgrade to the new amenity on this. The regional bus stop is at Kmart. Just wanted you to know here we took a lot of time to take a look at what the numbers were here because it was regional. Smartway stops here, and we looked at the numbers. It's about 17 or 18 people, but they actually stop through there 25 times a day. So there really weren't a lot of people at one time. We also know that a lot of them sit in their cars, and so we didn't really feel based on that. And BT and Radford only were running about two or three people each time they're running through there. So we really didn't think that bigger than a 12 by 8 was needed. But we did do a really big analysis on this because this is a regional stop. And we wanted to make sure that we had the right stop. We really feel like this is big enough. But we wanted to go on and add the barrel roof. We're going to put in a second bench, though, for people who might be waiting. And we're going to add in a bike rack. So we're going to really try to up this a little bit for that regional. The Kroger stop, we're going to do the barrel roof and add a trash can. Now, one thing I haven't talked about is with these roofs, we are going to start looking for power. If we can't get power, we're going to look at solar because we want lights inside these. That's going to be a standard that we want at all of them if we can. Okay, I can't do 100% guarantee, but we're trying to do that in our bid right now, is trying to get that solar in the light here if we can. Now you'll notice at North Franklin I'm putting no upgrades, and that's because with all the changes that are happening here with the roadways, we really felt after talking with the working group that to invest in a change in this, well, this will probably be moved with how the roadways are, that we'd rather wait, and when we make a change, we'll probably just put a new shelter in, because these shelters can't be moved, they're so old. Once you move them, you're really investing in a new shelter, so we really want to wait. So we're just going to let this one be as it is for right now, it can hold up, and we'll wait and see how the roadway looks. Because this is where your right-hand turn is and stuff, and so we're really taking a closer look at this one. The rec center, we're just doing the roof replacement. As you can tell, it has its other amenities. These pictures really help when you look. You can see that it already has most of the things that it needs. Now we're going to look at some where it needs new amenities or shelters. The Aquatic Center, we are looking at a bike rack that's been on our priority list. At the Government Center, it was so funny. I was so sure there was a bus shelter there. In my mind, I'd already put one there. I've been talking about it so long. My staff was just like, had to go take a picture for me. That's where the pictures came from. They were like, Becky, not there, just in your mind. Over Christmas, I'll put one there. So anyway, we're going to put one there, so there really will be one there for me. So we're going to put this here. It'll be a 4x8 shelter pad and light, a bench. The bike rack, I honestly have to look because I think there might be a bike rack someplace there already, so we may not need that. Trash can and your information display. This should be a place, of course, that should be a nice one for everybody. The Bluffs, another one that came up because of the ridership. We really would like to see a 4x8 shelter pad and light, bench, trash can, and information display. Walmart, we're still negotiating this out, whether it will be a shelter. The group has talked about maybe just a big cover over the top, but we can do a public-private partnership with them where maybe they put in some local match money. They're wonderful to work with. We just need to go and talk with them. And over the holidays, I just didn't have a chance to. So I'm going to go talk with them. We've had several conversations, and we're going to see if we can't finalize this up. We'll be somewhere over here where the shelter is now. They've been very nice about letting us use this area. And this is nice because it's right there where it's really safety for the passengers because it's right at the edge of Walmart, which is where we want to be. We want the we've talked about them one time. They've talked about their passengers being out in the kind of the center of the parking lot, and I was really against it because I don't want my passengers walking through the parking lot. And we really like this corner where it's really safe. And so if we can enhance this, this is where we'd like to do. So I'm going to go talk with them, and we're hoping this year we'll be able to firm up some stuff. And we've got the money, and so I think we'll be able to work out something here. The last thing is the Christiansburg Courthouse. We've been trying to move that stop for a while. Really tough. Had to move a sign. Finally moved the sign. We have it there on 110-13. We are now are officially moved from the flower stop, shop down there. We are stopping there now. So we are official.
Will there be a shelter there this morning?
We had talked about it, but with the covering here where people can stand right here, we had decided, the working group at this point had said that that was not their priority at this point, that their others were more of a priority. That doesn't mean it might not come back up again. If we see a lot of people who seem to need it in the next round, it might be brought back up again. But right now, I think we're going to test this out here and see how this works. And the other areas right now seem to really need it. There's still some other areas that the working group has me looking at that I just need to finish up some work on, and then I'll be back talking about them. There's still some other priority areas. I just haven't finished them all up yet. But these are all ready to go. I've passed my, done everything I need. We're working with everybody, the staff, and all we gotta do is start work on them, and by fall they'll all be up there. You'll see all the new domes up there. They're going to look really nice. Everything should be ready to go. And in fact, I probably will go on and do what's called, I will probably go on and do where I start the process before the funding even comes in, because the funding's going to come, it's just delayed, and we can go on and start the process so that we'll make sure we hit our mark. So we'll be okay. Any other questions? I'm very excited. We're excited. The working group has been very productive. They've done a lot of really digging in and talking about a lot of details to really get this out. You know, really looking at stops and really thinking about how to spend money and what's efficient. And they've done a lot of hard work. I mean, anything you want to add, Councilman?
If we ever decide who's going to put those shelters up,
we're working with Public Works in Christiansburg. So right now, we will not be putting them up. You all will be putting them up. Looking over that way.
I didn't want that to be a surprise to Mr. Nelson, because I know we had talked about that.
Yes.
So you've already alerted him.
Yes. No surprise, right?
No. No.
Everybody heard? Okay. All right. Nobody's scared off by this, right? Okay. And and we're going to help. We're here to help, and we'll do anything or train or anything else that's needed. We're not going to abandon or anything. So there's been lots of years of experience.
I appreciate you coming by here every couple of months, because for a while I did not see the light. But now lately I have seen the light, and by coming over here periodically, it helps me, reinforce me. So I want to thank you for that. The only other thing I have to say here on the Agency on Aging, I thought that she had her own transportation. I thought she had her own bus.
She finds people transportation. She doesn't have her own bus, she finds people transportation.
Oh, okay.
She is a mobility coordinator.
Okay.
So what she does is she finds people, whatever's out there.
So now
Blackbird Transit.
Now she's finding you?
Yep, she's finding us. So she's just helping us out. And she just tends to do work with people who, she does more of the off the regular circuit kind of stuff, you know? So, you know, we're just tapping what's out here, making sure we're coordinating.
Becky, this is the same lady we discussed at the other meeting.
Yes.
And she's part of that group also, and she does go, Steve, she goes around to all different areas. I mean, she goes from Floyd to Blacksburg to Pulaski and whatever.
Okay.
And her whole job is to try to make sure people are aware of the bus system and know how to use it.
Yeah, she's pretty impressive.
Thank you.
Any more questions of Ms. Barton? Good job, Becky.
Thank you all very much.
Look forward to our next meeting.
Thank you very much. Y'all have a great evening.
Very nice.
We have with us this evening Mr. Josh Smith, and he brought, I'll let you do the introduction.
Okay.
Mr. Smith is from Ignite.
Yes, sir. Mayor and council members, thank you for letting us come in tonight. This is Kenny, my less handsome counterpart. My name is Josh Smith. I'm with Ignite Academy, and we are, just to give a little brief snippet of who we are, we moved to the area a year and a half ago. The college, Ignite, started in California and it birthed in 2008. And when it got up and going, the campus that we are at now was formerly known as Life East Bible College. I spent 2 years here as a student there finished up out in California. Since then, when it closed down in 2003, it was remodeled, revamped as a conference center. Recently, we had a ribbon cutting ceremony out there on campus. And it was basically turnkey, so we have moved right in and have been evolving as a junior college. And so the focus of the program is fourfold. There's an emphasis on the Word of God, community involvement, global missions, and just hearing God's voice. And so it is a Christian junior college. The neat thing about it is that after their second year, they've earned their associate's degree in general studies with a biblical emphasis. We've got strong partnerships with Regent and Liberty, where they will let them enroll as distant learning students, and they can remain on campus with us and continue to evolve and grow into young leaders. And then after their fourth year, we deploy them, send them out. One of the main aspects of Ignite, the reason why I'm coming in here tonight, is since being here, we came in as the newbies. I love the community here, the fact that there are years and years and years of relationship within this community. And so learning how to get involved and plug in has been my responsibility for the college. We started one of our very first ones. We just happened to see an ad in the paper about the Wilderness Trail Festival. And so we just sent 15 students in the morning to help vendors set up. And then we left, we walked out, sent another group in at noon to help pick up trash on the streets and then pull them out. And then at the end of the day, we sent them back in. And so from there, we've kind of evolved in our areas that we do outreach. Agency on Aging was brought up tonight. We have partnered with them, Roanoke Rescue Mission, English Meadows, Feeding America, Habitat for Humanity just moved into Christiansburg here. We've been helping them out as well. And so our heart is to really get our students plugged into this community for as long as we have them. I'm coming tonight because we have a spring preview where students within this area and the surrounding states will come to check out Ignite. And one of the things that we've built into our preview is on March 9th, to give them a full taste of what Ignite is about, we are wanting to plan an outreach day for them. And I wanted to come to you and see if we could partner or if you could give me information on the upcoming things that are going on with the community so that we can be a part of that. I was under the impression or under the understanding that there's improvements or expansion of the park behind Kroger. We would love to be a part of that, and if that could happen on March 9th, coinciding with our spring preview, that would be beautiful. And again, it's not just a matter of us showing up and doing all of the work. We would really love for there to be a co-partnership with the community. And we're doing the same thing in Salem as well. We've got a church that's affiliated with our program in Salem, and we're working with Salem to do the same thing there. So all of our preview students will go to these two different locations, get a full picture of what Ignite is. That is my presentation. I've included in the packet a sample of our flyers that we're going to be handing out and posters. In my mind, I have a timeline of promoting our event, and that could happen as soon as the promoting of our preview is going to happen this weekend. We're going to blanket the town and ask owners if we can, business owners, if we can put up advertising and things like that. But any kind of partnership, any kind of, not only for March 9th, but on down the road, if there are things that come up, we want you to know that Ignite is here to serve, to give. We have a lot of strong young men and women who love to serve. And so I just hope that we can establish and build a strong relationship between Ignite and the city of Christiansburg.
Thank you, Mr. Smith. Any questions about the program?
I got a few questions, if I could.
Yes.
So you mentioned earlier that Liberty University and Regent University, Regent of the Beach, Liberty, of course, mm-hmm. up in Lynchburg, that you all have it's worked out to where the credits earned here,
yes.
up to a certain amount, I imagine, can be then used towards obtaining a bachelor's degree?
Yes, sir.
At either one of these universities via distance learning coordination?
Yes, and also with our mother college, Life Pacific, out in California, all credits transfer. And so between the three colleges, Life, Liberty, and Regent, I believe we're up to now 32 degrees that our students can choose from.
And as far as the I guess you obviously have a strong emphasis on community involvement, and is it that actually part of the requirements?
It's mandatory. All of we have 74 students, and every one of them, my job is every Saturday to send out 9 ministry teams or outreach teams to different locations, and so we've been very involved and wanting to increase our awareness of how we can help, where we can send students.
Can we change the film? Just
oh yeah.
Half second term.
Go ahead, Mr.
Thank you. Uh-oh. I know, just to pick back up. So you said there is a mandatory requirement of a certain number of hours. Is that per semester, per month? How do you do that? Per semester?
We do it by semester.
And
there's a target of 10 to 12 hours of serving.
Per person?
Per person.
And active enrollment, as far as what you anticipate, would be?
For a given
semester, how many
numbers? Well, the campus has the capacity of 300 students. We are, Kenny here is my recruiter, and our goal is to continue to grow Ignite. Right now we're 74 students, and our goal and our anticipation is to grow it to that, the capacity.
So my understanding there, just by the numbers, you have full capacity, you're looking at 3,600 hours community service in the local area every semester?
Yes.
And right now you're doing about 750, roughly.
We are.
Do you have any residents that stay on campus?
We have, our students, it's on-campus residency.
All of them?
All of them.
Wow.
Between, we have dorms as well as apartments. Okay. It was outfitted for a college.
Okay.
I don't know if this could go back to further history when it was originally being built as a Muslim mosque,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then Foursquare Movement mm-hmm. purchased it, and so it's gone through a number of changes.
We had the grand opening out there, I believe it was in October, wasn't it?
Yes.
And a beautiful facility, and they have conference facilities there as well. Unfortunately, it's just out of town,
mm-hmm.
but we'd like to do something about that someday. I would hope that.
Cats out of the bag now.
Cats out of the bag.
And Larry just stepped in the kitty litter.
I think I told the director we'd like to have him in town, but we don't handle that.
That is a nice conference.
One of the things that we need to do is to get our Director of Parks and Recreation briefed on what you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
And we have two great, huge activities this summer with the Little League,
right.
or the Dixie Youth League World Series, and then the other World Series is
U-triple-S-A.
Yeah, the U-triple-S-A. And there's going to be a lot of work in preparation and supervision,
sure.
and all of that. So something we might want to alert the Parks and Recreation Department that you're available if they need you.
Yes, and during the summertime, the students do take off to their, whether it be homes and whatnot. We are building into our program a summer internship that is not only for our college students, but we also want to tap into our juniors and seniors. I could go on and on about our program and what's down the road, but we would just love to be considered for things that are on the calendar.
I'd like to mention, Josh had indicated that they started a couple of years ago helping with the Wilderness Trail Days that the Kiwanis Club puts in. And, you know, these young men and women are down there at 5 o'clock in the morning helping the vendors. And the vendors have told all of us in the club that they have never been to any other craft show. And most of these people go to a craft show every weekend. They said they've never, ever been to a craft show that they have kids that will come and help them set up, unpack, pack, take everything down. And it's really amazing to watch these kids. They're energetic, they're happy, they're not afraid to do, to do anything we ask them to do. And they've helped make our event successful in the fact that all us 65-year-old guys don't have to do that at 5 o'clock. We're all there, but we got somebody we can point and shout to.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Whatever. You've never been there, have you? Okay. But it is, they have been a real help. I've noticed you at the bowling alley with the Leisure Directions. That's the old name. But I think you've been mentoring some with the group over there that bowls. I've seen you there.
Yes, we went we assisted with the Special Olympics, not only the bowling, but also they do a huge basketball tournament at Virginia Tech, and we helped there as well.
I think you did it Thursday night regular group. Mm-hmm. I've seen you there quite a bit too. Yes.
Did the name of our town have anything to do with you locating here?
I don't know, but it fits, doesn't it? It fits.
Is there anything that we as a town, I know that you've got some brochures and handouts. Is there any kind of website stuff we can do or get them on the website as a thing? Becky, I don't whoever handles that, is there anything we can do at least to promote this day of community work that they're wanting to do?
I want to sit down and talk with them about what the parameters of it are.
Okay.
To see if it fits within our guidelines, but certainly.
Sure. And I do want to, I did mean to say that this is not anything where we are proselytizing or anything. This is strictly, we want to bring bodies and manpower to a community need. And so it's strictly serving. There's no evangelistic or, like I said, proselytizing or anything. And so we're very cautious. We're very pliable anywhere we go. We've also gone, we take all of our students through national required background checks where they are interviewed, they go through video training. We work with a lot of children, and so it brings comfort to the organization. So I would hope and I believe that we would be able to comply with any structure that you have.
Now, are you going to seek out individual, like an elderly lady or man that might need yard work done that day? Is that into the same thing you're looking for from an individual standpoint?
Yes, I've been checking, our generation is in the Craigslist thing, so I've been checking Craigslist for people that post for help. Mm-hmm. Agency on Aging, we've gone from Floyd to Radford, various places around Blacksburg, Christiansburg. Those are the, Agency on Aging does a very good job of seeking out those that need help, and so we're not wanting to reinvent the wheel. We really want to rely on those that have already got a system in place. But we do, I guess, sometimes we do do it on our own where we've gone and just done door-to-door. Anybody that looks like they need their yard raked, we'll go provide those services. So.
I haven't seen them boys up around my house. Let me give you my address where they are.
Brad Epperly, do you have one of those?
I do not.
But you're connected.
I would like to. I'm the director of Parks and Recreation, okay. And we would love to have any assistance
okay.
help that
very nice.
You can give. We have a lot of projects that go on throughout our parks, and sometimes we need some labor. there's other items that we need, and so you know, we're always willing to work together with organizations that are willing to donate time and those types of items and help. And so I'm sure that we can look at some things in the future and work together.
I'll give him this. I'm 100% behind you. I know these are expensive, so I'll give. Be happy to share that with you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, and we'll make our director of the Aquatic Center aware of all this, too.
I already have a job for you March 9th.
Okay, very good.
All right, thank you, Mr. Smith.
Thank you very much.
Best wishes to you. Is there anyone else that would like to address council on any matter this evening? Now's your chance. Okay, seeing none, then we'll close the citizens' hearing portion and go to item number 3, which is a resolution supporting the designation of the Crooked Road, the Virginia Heritage Music Trail, as a national heritage area. We had had a request through their director, Mr. Hinchelwood, that the national heritage folks would like to know who is supporting the Crooked Road, so that when they make a decision as far as making it a site for the National Heritage Foundation. You should have that resolution in your packet. I'll give you a minute to look it over.
Well, I've read it, and I'll make a motion that we go forward with the resolution.
Okay. I'll second that.
All right. Motion and a second to adopt this resolution, and Ms. Clerk, we'll need to get the name of the second and the maker of the motion added to it. All in favor of adopting this resolution in support of the National Heritage Foundation making the Crooked Road a site, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. And we will let Mr. Hinchelwood know by either email or snail mail of your action. Second is a resolution supporting Safe Route to School Infrastructure Grant application. And you should have that resolution also in your packet. And Mr. Helms, you want to address this? It's a grant application, and it's for
mostly sidewalks and
sidewalks and whatever we can do to make the infrastructure safe for kids walking to school.
I'll make a motion we accept the resolution.
I'll second.
Motion and a second to adopt this resolution, and your vote has to be recorded as part of the resolution. So Ms. Clerk, will you poll council?
Yes, sir. Councilman Barber?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Hupper?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
Councilman Van Hooser?
Aye. That motion carries. Thank you.
Can I make a brief comment on
yes,
that?
Yes, sir.
I appreciate all the work that Nicole's done to get this application done, and I'm sure there are others, but we pulled it out front with this. Also, like there's a number, I think there's a police officer here. One of our police officers, Donnie Cromer, has been the flag bearer for this behind the scenes, pushing quietly, or maybe not so quietly, I don't know. But that's the type of pushing that we appreciate. I appreciate to have that, we appreciate having that support for seeking these worthwhile funds. So I just want to recognize Donnie's, I know Mr. Crummer's been behind the scenes also cultivating that. Having that support from inside is really appreciated. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Next on the agenda is the consideration of accepting a reimbursement grant from the Virginia Tourism Corporation for a Love Works sculpture. And I think you were given a memo prior to sitting down here about this project and what it's all about. we have applied and we have received reimbursement grant from the tourism folks for the Love Works artwork that portrays the message that love is the heart of every Virginia vacation. Do we have, it's kind of like the Hokey Bird.
So.
Becky can go into details.
It's a,
have we already received
the word grant? Love, and it's mobile, right? And no, it's not.
This one won't be mobile.
It's not mobile. They have a mobile version that you could rent for $500 per week. But we went with the permanent version. That would need to be up for at least 1 year after March 31st. And we felt like the Aquatic Center was a very visible location as far as lots of traffic going by, and chose items that we felt would be representative of tourism attractions and what makes Christiansburg attractive to tourists. And so aquatics and parks and recreation, as well as shopping and dining, were what we focused on for it. So there is a artistic rendering on the back page there that we took some creative liberties with. So those are forks, not pitchforks. But what Virginia Tourism Corporation needs from us at this time is simply to accept that we would like to move forward with the project, and we do expect the cost of the project to exceed the reimbursement amount, which is $1,200 max. So what we are looking at cost-wise would be $1,600 would be the town's portion in order to get that project completed. And it's very large. The letters have to be at least 6 feet tall, so it will be quite visible, quite the photo opportunity for people to stop by.
And that will be at the Aquatic Center?
Yes, sir.
Christiansburg is for lovers, is that?
Something like that, yeah.
Don't quite come out that way.
You can actually go on the Virginia Tourism website and see what other communities have done. They're pretty neat.
This will be one of approximately
20
throughout the state.
And we'll be on their website also.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we'll need a motion to accept that reimbursement. We have a motion, Mr. Barber,
yes.
And a
second
from Mr. Showalter. All in favor of accepting this reimbursement grant from the Tourism Corporation, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. And that motion carries.
One question, thank you. Is somebody going to be sort of in charge of keeping this or changing it? Or
it's going to be a permanent structure.
Changes throughout the year?
No, everything will be permanently adhered to it. So it's just like any sort of sculpture that you might see on display in a municipality. So other than if it were to be vandalized in some way or anything like that, it's really not going to require any additional upkeep other than what's presently done to that hillside, which is just the mowing. So just be mowing around it.
Okay, thank you, Becky. Next on the agenda is council's appointments to the Planning Commission, and you took that action in December. We interviewed two candidates to fill two vacancies, and you appointed those on condition that their criminal background checks came back clean.
Your background checks.
Background checks.
Criminal background.
No, background.
Just background checks.
No criminal. All
right. Well, that would
show up.
But the intent is a background check.
All right, I stand corrected. Anyway, they came back clean, and your vote was that they would be appointed on condition that they got a good report. So
they're appointed.
They're appointed.
Thanks again for
now. We had one fellow that could not be here because of a conflict, and we do have another vacancy on the Planning Commission. We don't have to fill it, but I think we really need to interview this third fellow. It wasn't his fault that he couldn't get here. He was trying his best he could and got tied up in traffic. on the interstate.
Best of my knowledge, we only have the one vacancy left over, Mr. Mayor.
Yeah, we have the one vacancy, but we hadn't really planned to fill it, but we can fill it.
Well, I think we should act on the two we have tonight.
Yes.
And we'll set, if we decide, we'll set an interview later for the third candidate.
But we need to give this man an opportunity to sit before us and let us.
Well, we've already acted on these two. All we have to do is notify them.
They're already appointed. I don't think they're either one are here.
Yes, one is here.
Okay. Kind of wave back there. Let me see.
Yes.
There he is.
Whereas we appointed them last time on condition, they've already been tentatively appointed. There's no formal action required.
That's right. They've already been appointed. And if you will, Mr. Mayor, make sure they understand that they are appointed.
They're stuck.
And let's go ahead and let someone work to get the other gentleman in. We can interview him at least.
Yeah. Well, we did that prior to a council meeting the last time. If you want to set something up prior to a council meeting, we can do that.
Has he contacted us again to try to request another meeting date or fair?
He just let us know that day that he couldn't be here and that he would like to be interviewed, but he just couldn't get here.
And we conducted those interviews on
December
5th or 19th.
Second Tuesday.
Second.
Second December, right?
Third
Tuesday.
We don't meet on the second.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, we don't meet on the second.
December 18th. So it's been, has there been any contact?
Can you contact him and see if he still wants to be interviewed? And then we'll set a time when he can come and talk to council. If you can do that for us, that'll be a big help. All right, next on the agenda is Mr. Stipes and Mr. Van Hoosier, Street Committee report.
It's easy peasy lemon squeeze tonight. This is one that was more, I think it was, Barry, when was this before council before and it was withdrawn?
It was withdrawn. They vacated some easements first.
Okay.
So they could extend this.
So they could extend.
Okay. This is in Kensington. It's the next phase, phase five. And it is, the street committee's reviewed this and it is in conformance with the subdivision ordinance as well as the master plan, the approved master plan for the development. And the street committee recommends approval of the plat as presented and will make that recommendation in the form of a motion.
I'll second that.
Motion and a second. Discussion. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed, no. Motion carries.
Councilman Van Hoosier, is there anything else from the street committee? We're having some more discussion perhaps on Patrick, or we had the resolution on the prioritization and so forth, and traffic signalization is going to be recurring. You know, we're going to track that. There was a letter reviewed also concerning new Quinn Stewart Boulevard, again, that was shared by the town manager.
In discussing that, Mr. Stipes, you mentioned the intersection of North Franklin and Cambria. You said
Patrick's Way is one. The same things is we need to carefully track these and install them when they're warranted and follow a plan for doing so, because if we follow the guidelines to do that, then if we don't follow a plan for doing that, then we'll find ourselves installing one and have seven others.
Sure. And did you mention traffic light synchronization? Basically, what one of the aspects has been looked at.
That was in the resolution before that we just approved.
From Cambry Street to Independence.
I need to make a recommendation on that one, and then you had a public hearing on, hadn't been approved yet.
Oh,
right. That's the next thing.
That's the next thing.
Okay. That's the next thing.
Okay, that's in the resolution.
Right,
Mr. Hall. Okay, thank you.
Okay. Nothing else?
Mayor, I just talk about street committee here. That stop sign that had been put in on Miller and Allegheny, I'm not sure who was responsible for it, but that had really slowed down the traffic. I know that it slowed down me.
Brought you to a screech halt a couple times, did it up.
So I think that was really an idea, and whoever done it, I think the citizens should be pleased with that too. Definitely slowed down the traffic.
I've heard a lot of complaints about the stop sign on Sleepy Hollow, but most of them have been from people that are 18 years old or younger. And that's no joke.
We use it as a threat. We're going to do it this way. If you don't heed it, we're going to go to speed bumps about 4 feet tall.
Well, I go through Sleepy Hollow quite frequently, and it works.
Yeah.
I gave Ms. Turner credit for that stop sign.
She'll take it.
Put a sign on that thing, the Connie Turner Memorial Stop Sign.
But it has slowed things down, and I'm appreciative of it. Okay, let's go get to the CUP request by Shaw for the Fisher Street project.
Now, wait a minute. B.
Finally, resolution.
Oh, B. I'm sorry. I've got ahead of myself.
Okay. Mr. Helms has already reviewed B, and that's the resolution that's before you, include those three projects. And the second one is new to the list, and that's the one that's more realistic as far as the funding standpoint goes, to tidy up the intersection with Cambria and North Franklin, as well as study the three intersections, Mr. Hall, from Cambria, Independence, all the way down to Independence and Patrick's Way in the middle.
Okay.
And I believe you have that resolution in your package. Yes.
And the street committee recommends that we adopt this resolution.
Yes.
And I would make that in form of motion.
I'll second it.
We have a motion by Mr. Van Hoosier, a second by Mr. Stipes, to adopt the resolution in support of including North Franklin Street, Cambria Street intersection project in the VDOT project programming. I think probably we need to do a voice vote on this one, Ms. Clerk.
Yes, sir. Councilman Barber.
Aye.
Councilman Hall.
Aye.
Councilman Hufford.
Aye.
Councilman Showalter.
Aye.
Councilman Stipes.
Aye.
Councilman Van Hoosier.
Aye.
And that motion carries. Thank you. Now let's move to the Fisher Street conditional use permit. We have a recommendation from the Planning Commission.
Yes, sir, we do. Whereas Christiansburg Planning Commission acted upon a request by Christiansburg Town Council to study a request made by Shaw Development conditional use permit for property located 115 Fisher Street Northeast for residential use in the B3 General Business District, as found following a duly advertised public hearing that the public necessity, convenience, general welfare, and good zoning practices permit the issuance of CUP to Shaw Development for conditional use permit for property located at 115 Fisher Street Northeast for residential use in the B3 General Business District. Therefore, be it resolved, Christiansburg Planning Commission recommends Christiansburg Town Council approve the conditional use permit with the following condition: the development be in substantial compliance with the attached concept drawing, with the addition of a hammerhead at the south side of the property, latitude to adjust the trees as most appropriate, and the consideration of stormwater management in the green area on the west side of the property. Date is 10th day of December 2012. Is approved 7 yes and 1 absent.
Okay.
Mr. Mayor, I would move that we accept the recommendation of the Planning Commission with the conditions as stated therein.
I'll second it.
Motion by Mr. Hall, second by Mr. Barber, to approve the CUP. Ms. Clerk, poll council, please.
Yes, sir. Councilman Barber.
Aye.
Councilman Hall.
Aye.
Councilman Hufford.
Aye.
Councilman Showalter.
Aye.
Councilman Stipes.
Aye.
Councilman Van Hoosier.
Aye.
And that passes 6-0. Thank you. And Mr. Rutledge. Past your bedtime, go home. Next on the agenda is the approval for the fire department ladder truck, cost of $737,000 approximately.
Make the motion, we move forward with the plan.
Motion by Mr. Stipes, second by Mr. Huppert to approve. Since there's a lot of money involved here, Ms. Clerk, will you poll council again?
Yes, sir. Councilman Barber?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Huppert?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
Councilman Van Hoosier?
Aye.
And that motion carries. Thank you. Chief, buy that truck. We have a request for a closed meeting under Virginia Code Section 2.237.11A5 for discussion concerning a prospective business or industry or the expansion of an existing business or industry where no previous announcement has been made of the business or industry's interest in locating or expanding its facilities in the community. And we also have a request for closed session, same general.
The same.
State that again. State it again, Mr. Hall. Do you have the code number?
2.2-371183.
Okay.
Which would be the acquisition or disposition of real property.
He's an attorney. He knows all this.
And Mr. Mayor, I would make a secondary motion on top of that closed session motion. I would ask that Brad Epperly be present during that closed session as a director of Parks and Recreation.
We can invite him without a motion.
Yes,
sir. All right. That would be the second portion of a closed meeting. All right. All in favor of going into closed session, please say aye.
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 Oh, we have to poll council. I'm sorry.
I'm sorry, could I get the motion in the second?
It was Mr. Hall, I believe, that made the motion, and I...
Yes, sir. I think Mr. Barber was second.
And Mr. Barber seconded it.
Thank you. Councilman Barber?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Huppert?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
Councilman Van Hoosier?
Aye.
That motion carries. We're going to be in closed session.
Mr. Mayor?
We need to take a...
I think we have to take both those separately.
Yeah, we have
that's
to take
two closed sessions.
Since they both pertain to
different
sections,
real estate or whatever. All right, we have a motion and a second for that closed session. Ms. Clerk, you'll poll council.
You're still going to use Mr. Hall's.
I would make that motion again, Your Honor, Mr. Mayor.
All right, second it.
Second.
And Ms. Clerk, if you'll poll council again.
Yes, sir. Councilman Barber?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Huppert?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
Councilman Van Hoosier?
Aye.
All right, we're going to take about a 5-minute recess and declare council chambers.
Is that it?
Yep.
Yep, you're on.
All right. Go ahead, Mr. Hubbard.
I move to certify that the town council of the town of Christiansburg, meeting in closed meeting, in the best of each member's knowledge, discussed only public business matters, lawfully exempted from open meeting requirements by the Virginia law. And the only such matters as are identified in the resolution to enter the closed meeting.
Second.
A motion and a second. Let me ask the question before we vote on this. Since we had two public hearings, do we have to do two certifications?
We just certify both of them at the same time.
At the same time.
Good. Yeah. That's what we've done.
All right. Ms. Clerk, will you poll council?
Yes, sir. Councilman Barber?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Huppert?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
Councilman Van Hoosier?
Aye.
And that's a 6-0 vote. We're out of closed session. We're back in regular session now. And Mr. Town Manager, I think you're on.
Okay. I'd like to set two public hearings for the 19th of February. The first one requested by the Planning Commission. I'd like to address change to Administrative Code for requests. For rezoning the condition. Okay, if they have unpaid taxes. If they have unpaid taxes or bills that they can't process a CUP or rezoning without taking care of this first.
Okay.
The second is for changing our ordinance for high grass to take into account conservation easements and or town controlled property. And where it's going to come into effect is along the creek in Diamond Hills Park. It's going to be a conservation easement. We're supposed to leave it in natural state as much as possible. So right now, we wouldn't be able to finance our own ordinance if we proceed with it.
You want to set that for?
Both of them for the 19th of February.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second. Discussion. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, no. Motion carries.
And I've been asked, do we want to set the joint or public hearing yet? Flaxburg has their set for the 22nd.
22nd of January.
Excuse me.
We were hoping to try to get pretty close to their public hearing.
I'd prefer to just wait a little bit on that and see how things kind of fall into place.
Oh, you know, they're going to look to join it.
I've heard a lot of things come out of Blacksburg. I don't know.
Yeah.
Might be 5-1-4.
Having a public hearing doesn't affect,
right.
You wouldn't be voting, just seeing
just
the public
hearing. Just public hearings, see what the, yeah. See what the public
hearing. We have a certain number of dates, how many days is it following the public hearing that we have to take action? Or was it 60 days, 60 days or so?
I don't know offhand, I'd have to look that up.
Would you want to consider?
If we didn't vote on that at the time, having a public hearing.
That's right, we could.
I'd be fine having a public hearing. I did talk to, I support the vote. Public hearing if it doesn't cause any angst with anybody. I mean, just things as a housekeeping item.
That's for what night?
I'd recommend that the 19th also.
Could we move it then, if we have two on the 19th to the in March then, or would y'all want to do on the 19th?
First meeting in March.
First meeting in March.
That'll be early on in the agenda. We won't get bogged down until later.
Public hearing, right?
That's all it is.
I doubt that we're going to have too many people.
The
Walmart and
Blacksburg is going to have theirs when?
Next week.
22nd.
Okay, so the 22nd of this month. So we'll have we'll have a month. Yeah, let's go. February 19th. I'm like the 19th.
Did you make a motion, Mike?
I did.
I second.
A motion and a second to have this public hearing on Joinder on February 19th. You're killing me, folks. You're killing me.
Court will support that.
So we do have a
medication you want.
And we do have a motion and a second.
When are we doing?
19th.
We're looking to set the Joinder public hearing on February 19th. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no.
No.
That's three public hearings on one right now. That's not going to create a problem.
No.
I'll go down 10.
Okay, Mr.
Can we separate them out?
Town manager.
Do you want to separate?
We already voted on first two.
Yeah, that was just the last one.
Then no, this one.
Have one taxi cab driver permit application. It's for Alvin Vincent Underwood Jr. The police department checked them out and said they're okay and recommended approval. So I'd recommend approval of him for the taxi cab driver.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second. Discussion.
Can he appear before council so we can meet him? It's getting late.
All in favor of approving the taxi license, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed,
aye.
No. Thank you.
Okay.
put a copy of proposed budget policy at your place, and we'll be on the agenda at the next meeting for discussion and approval. VML Legislative Days on January 31st. I think everyone has responded and wants to go. To Michelle, you've got Mr. Hubbard, Mr. Van Hoosier, the mayor. Is that anyone else? Okay.
Randy.
And Randy, yes. And the VML Legislative Bulletins, last year I forwarded them to you as I got them from VML. Is anybody, is that okay? Anybody doesn't want me to, I'll take you off the list.
Personally good if you don't.
Okay.
I mean, unless you see something that affects us.
I think I've been sending them too.
Oh, okay.
I'd rather get the nice meaty updates that you have on stuff in town.
We got the Reader's Digest.
I'd rather get those nice meaty updates.
They're bridged.
I'm gonna quit sending them to you. They wanted a liaison person, a contact person, so I told them I would do it, but I don't want to send them to you if you don't want them.
I don't want to down until you gave up and quit.
Well, I don't read all those things.
And Ms. Tweedy agreed to respond to ones that deal with finance to come in, how they would affect us back to VML so they can respond and lobby appropriately. So she's providing a lot of input into new legislation. That's all I have.
All right. I did write letters to the congressmen and senators that were listed on the last VML request, and that was for them to get off of it and vote for this, vote on this fiscal cliff thing, which they did. Not because I sent them a letter, but they did.
Well, yeah, they did. They did.
I didn't hear a lot of mention that. It's
Nobody sent them. Yeah, they got in touch with us.
I've got just a couple things. I was contacted by a merchant downtown during the holiday season that there were some issues with the Christmas store and parking on Main Street. And basically the downtown parking was taken up and their customers couldn't get there. And they mentioned in years past that the store actually had volunteers out there making sure people didn't park there. And I guess the request is that we open a dialogue or talk to either whomever's running the Christmas store, the staff, and see what we can get done for them during their season for the Christmas store. Maybe get those volunteers back out there, but at least there was a complaint. I think our main thing is our merchants downtown. The Christmas store is a great idea, but we need to venture those people out to the church parking lots and things like that instead of taking up merchant parking.
My understanding,
30-minute limit on the parking down there. That'll move them out pretty quick.
Yeah, it was my understanding there were more than just one merchant that was concerned about the parking.
You're right.
So, let's get with Chief Sisson, and we've got a year to study this thing, and let Street Committee kind of take a look at it, too, along with the Christmas store officials to see if we can work something out.
The second thing, Mayor, is, and I know that the Finance Committee's got a meeting come up, but I would like to get a recommendation from them on our addendum when we come back in 2 weeks, our public hearing, the addendum to the budget.
Well, I think we'll consider that as a group, won't we?
Well, you're meeting within the next 2 weeks to talk about 2013-14.
Yes,
I mean, if you can...
Basically, you're wanting a recommendation from us that we approve the amendments we talked about tonight to the budget.
That's fine. The amendments that are on the sheet.
Yes,
yeah.
That we got.
Yeah.
The sheet,
yeah.
That we have published.
And we're going to have an adjusted figure, so we could have that at that time.
That's a good point. We've got something to act on then.
You can get a little bit more intimate with your questions. Mm-hmm. I mean, in a formal setting, it can be difficult and lengthy. Mm-hmm. And also the budget policy, too. You take a look at that.
All right. Anything else?
One quick comment, Mr. Mayor. Last night, I believe Mr. Ruffinetti and Mr. Coyle were present at a meeting with the Board of Supervisors concerning the where we have requested they sign off and allow us to bill in the county, the compassionate billing procedures we're trying to put in town. My understanding is the reception that was received by Mr. Quill and perhaps even Mr. Carpenter as well was, I will say, less than thrilled, if I may. And I believe that they handled themselves very well. I had a conversation late last night. I guess the meeting must have went until after 10. I was on my way back to Greensboro. I got a conversation with a member of the Board of Supervisors, and it seems to me that if this board, this council, I feel like it's up in the air with the county. And it's unfortunate because of the public safety issue, which is why we're approaching this. The question I have is that if this council would send a letter to the Board of Supervisors, letting them know as to what, why we are, not so much why we're requesting them to take that action, but why we're looking at doing that and what we're looking to do with those expected funds that will be realized through the compassionate billing practices. In other words, if we're looking to reinvest those in emergency services or if we're looking at those in another fashion. I think we've talked about it before, but nothing, it never really formal. But if we were to send a letter to the Board of Supervisors within the next couple of weeks on that topic, I think it may go a long way into either, I think some of their people that may be on the fence may be swayed one way or the other.
Well, I think an email from the mayor
would be fine.
An email will get their attention from either the mayor or the town manager that reminds them that we have 40% of our calls.
That's exactly
outside.
Right.
Yeah, and we could limit those 40% calls.
But I guess
in the future.
The concern I always have is that, you know, if we did limit, and I agree with you, they give us, what, 70,000 or 80,000 plus there's that capital fund every year, but they can kind of rotate when they provide a truck or an ambulance or something. The concern, though, is that, you know, if we didn't answer those calls, then they were going to do it themselves or try to do it themselves. And what does that mean? It goes our taxes again. So they kind of have this over our head a little bit. Yeah. But I think that if we were to, if there's a commitment that we had to reinvest in emergency services, I think that may be all it takes.
I think that was the only thing we were going to do with it.
I think that's exactly what we talked about. But we had never formally said that. If that was something we all agree on and we sent that letter, I think that will take care of it.
Upon unanimous consent from our council, the mayor can send an email to get their attention.
Yeah, I'll get with Mr. Helms and we'll put together a joint email. I think with having his name on there might
both
give it a little more credence.
Yes.
To
an email.
Just go back and tell me either approve it
Barry
or we'll put that damn joint or study buried till 2020.
Well, I would like to bring up one thing that pertains to that is one of the board members highly suggested that Mr. Coyle go back and get a vote from his volunteers whether or not we want to do this. I told Mr. Coyle no. Council made that decision. He would not get a vote from the crew. So if y'all get flack over that,
I don't see why, quite frankly. We respect our volunteers and we're indebted to our volunteers. But if a member of the Board of Supervisors cannot differentiate between the necessities of Christiansburg and Blacksburg as far as having access to volunteers, for crying out loud, that's one of the most blatant things you can see between the two towns. They have 30-plus thousand we don't have access to. They have 30-plus thousand that, you know, are going to school and have a lot more free time than our citizens that are working class here, blue-collar town in Christiansburg.
Let's give everything benefit of the doubt because I'm about ready to jump on a train and say something I'll regret.
Yeah, let's
can we go back into closed session?
No, we're in open session.
We're about to leave here.
I'm comfortable with the mayor and Mr. Hans.
Yeah, let's send an email. Let's offer the olive branch and hopefully that's all it is.
An email, I take it, would just say that we are looking to take those funds and reinvest them in emergency services.
I thought they had already voted on this.
That benefits the county because almost half of our
40%. That's thousands of calls.
Barry, remember.
We can work that into the ordinance too, if there's any questions.
Certainly.
Sure.
Mr. Mayor, may I ask one question to Mr. Carpinetti while he's here? And you were there last night, Adam, is that right?
Yes.
Was that kind of the tenor that you came out of that, expecting that they almost wanted to kind of know fine tuned as to what we were looking to do this for, as far as not a revenue stream, but actually reinvestment? Is that was a key issue?
I don't know if it was a key issue, but it was one of them.
Okay.
Board of Supervisors has said that they are going to come back to us with some questions for us to.
That'd be great.
Well, we'll answer a question before they come back with questions.
Yeah, there you go.
Thank you, Mr. Carpenter.
All right.
You know, I wanted to bring out one thing too while we're talking about parks, and we haven't really talked about the Depot Park or the potential for the Rosa Peters to get and interconnected with that, but I hope that council doesn't forget about that. I think it's an outstanding situation we have there that can develop it without spending a whole lot of money. And I'm hoping that maybe this spring that I can go there and talk to the Rosa Peters people. Mm-hmm. And also, maybe we're going to get the brushwork between the two little parks. But I think that's something we shouldn't forget about. It's something that we...
No, let me and let Mary handle that negotiations with them. They sort of resented, I think, when we came before them the last time. They thought we were trying to push something over on them. So, anyway, that's kind